Hello everyone, welcome to fifth lecture for the course Refrigeration and Air Conditioning. Myself Sumit Bardia, Assistant Professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Sharad Institute of Technology, College of Engineering, etc. Today we will go with the methods of refrigeration. Today we'll cover the following points like refrigeration terminology, methods of refrigeration under that evaporative refrigeration, vapor refrigeration system, steam jet refrigeration, vortex tube refrigeration, thermoelectric and magnetic refrigeration system. Refrigeration terminology. These terminologies are very much important to understand the further lectures and to calculate the parameters in the refrigeration system. First terminology is refrigeration load. Refrigeration load is the amount of heat which must be removed per unit time from a cold region. It is also known as refrigeration capacity. It is measured in terms of tons of refrigeration TR and is designated as RE. Sometimes it is also referred as refrigeration effect. Second terminology is mass flow rate of refrigerant. The refrigeration capacity of a system decides the mass flow rate of refrigerant when working under specified conditions. That is, mass flow rate of refrigerant is nothing but it is the ratio of refrigeration capacity to the refrigerating effect per kg of refrigerant. Next is evaporation capacity. It is the refrigeration effect produced at the evaporator of a refrigeration system equivalent to the refrigeration capacity. The evaporator is a device that consists of a long thin tubing where the refrigerant evaporates by absorbing its heat of evaporation from the surrounding. So that is about the evaporation capacity. Next is freezer. It is the term used in the household refrigerator. We all know that it is a place very near to the evaporator coils, so the liquid can be easily freezed to the solid state. It is also called chiller. Next is frosting. It is the deposition of ice on the evaporator coils due to its very low temperature. When air passes over the extremely cold coils, the moisture in the air separates and deposits on coils and gets solidified to form frosting. This frosting is a very bad conductor of heat and reduces the heat transfer from cold region to refrigerant. Thus, the refrigeration load increases. Therefore, it is always recommended that this frost or ice that is deposited on the coils must be removed from the evaporator coils regularly. The removal of ice from the evaporator coil is called as defrostation. So, we have one knob in our refrigerator to defrost it. So, in order to remove the ice which is formed or deposited on the evaporator coils. The last one is capillary tube. Capillary tube is a long and narrow tube connecting the condenser directly to the evaporator. The refrigerant passes through this tube by capillary action, that is by drop by drop. Thus the fluid friction and flashing of liquid refrigerant into the vapor due to heat transfer cause the pressure drop in the tube. For a given state of refrigerant, the pressure drop is directly proportional to the length of the tube and the inversely proportional to the diameter of the tube. So capillary tube is we are using in the refrigerators in order to expand the refrigerant. So these the major important terminology we have discussed. Next we'll go through the methods of refrigeration. Methods of refrigeration. We all know that the American Society of Refrigerating Engineers defines refrigeration as the science of producing and maintaining temperatures below that of surrounding atmosphere. This implies the development of temperature differential rather than the establishment of a given temperature level. The science of refrigeration utilizes several methods of providing temperature differential. They vary from the simplicity of the spring house, where cool water removes heat from the warm fresh milk, to the complex machinery required for the manufacture of ice cream or the production of considerably low temperature. We have already discussed that in olden days, natural ice was used for refrigeration purposes, which was quite inconvenient and inadequate for large requirements. The different techniques are developed in the last 100 years, and now there are numerous applications of refrigeration in our daily life as well as in many industries we are using. In different types of refrigeration systems, some physical property of matter is used for producing cold. The principles of different methods of refrigeration we will discuss one by one. So evaporative refrigeration, it is one of the very much important method of refrigeration, where heat is absorbed when the liquid evaporates. Evaporation of water is an example. Evaporation of moisture from the skin surface of a man helps to keep him cool. Another common example of this principle is a desert bag, used to keep drinking water cool. This bag consists of tightly woven fabric filled with the drinking water. The bag is not waterproof. Consequently, some water through and surface of the bag remains moist. Under desert conditions, which are usually hot and dry, moisture on the surface of the bag evaporates rapidly. A large part of heat necessary to cause this evaporation comes from the bag water. This removal of heat cools the drinking water inside the canvas, keeping it at a temperature several degrees below the temperature of surrounding. If we consider one more example, that water evaporation of refrigerant is the method of making artificial snow. Some of us have seen the artificial snow production in the various resorts, various play in the Dreamland or any other resorts. They are using as the evaporative refrigeration for production of artificial snow. This device consists of water nozzle. So this is the device, water nozzle, through which a high pressure jet of air, is inserted. Water flows from the nozzle and high pressure air flowing out with water causes the water to break up into tiny droplets. Here tiny droplets are there. If the surrounding air temperature is nearly freezing, so surrounding air nearly freezing or below freezing, the droplets of water tend to evaporate from their surface and rapidly cool to the point that tiny drops of ice are formed. In using this method, artificial snow is made when the temperature of surrounding should be 0 degrees Celsius or maybe lower. However, if the relative humidity is low, artificial snow can be made when the temperature is as high as 2 degrees Celsius. This is because of the rapid evaporation and evaporative cooling, which is caused by the low relative humidity air. Evaporative condensers are often used in connection with air conditioners. The evaporation of water helps in reducing the quantity of water required for cooling in the condenser, which is used in the refrigeration plant. So that is about the evaporative refrigeration. Next is vapor refrigeration system. So figure shows a typical vapor compression refrigeration system. In a vapor refrigeration system, instead of air vapors, like ammonia, carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide are used as working fluids. The vapor reference system works on the reverse cycle which is used for steam power plants. The pump in the steam power plant is replaced by a throttle valve, boiler is replaced by a refrigerator, and turbine is replaced by a compressor. The heat carried away by the air from the refrigerator in an air refrigeration system is in the form of sensible heat. As there is no change of phase, so that the effectiveness of air reference system is less. In a vapor refrigeration system, heat carried away by the vapor in the refrigerant in the form of latent heat. So that the capacity of refrigeration of vapor reference system per kg of refrigerant is far superior than the air refrigeration system. Typically, the vapor refrigeration system is divided into two types. One is the vapor compression refrigeration system. Second one, vapor absorption refrigeration system. The difference between vapor absorption and vapor compression system is in the manner in which external heat is added to the vaporized refrigerant to increase its thermal level above atmosphere, which is very necessary to reject the heat in the condenser. In case of vapor compression system, the refrigerant vapor here, the refrigerant vapor is sucked into the compressor and is compressed, adding the energy in the form of work to increase its thermal level above atmosphere. In case of absorption reference system, a working fluid is taken which has high affinity to dissolve in water. The refrigerant which is commonly used in ammonia is used in the absorption reference system. The liquid strong in ammonia is heated further by the application of external heat to generate vapor, and its temperature is increased above atmospheric temperature. A distinct advantage of absorption system over the compression system is reduced noise due to the absence of compressor. Compressor having internal motor is there, so that creates noise. So that comparison, the vapor absorption system is noiseless. Next is steam jet refrigeration system. This system uses the principle of boiling the water below 100 degrees Celsius. If the pressure on the surface of water is reduced below atmospheric pressure, then the water boils at 6 degrees Celsius if the pressure or the surface is 5 cm of water, and 10 degrees Celsius if the pressure is 6.5 cm of water. The very low pressure or high vacuum on the surface of the water can be maintained by throttling the steam through the jets or nozzle. So that arrangement is shown in the figure. Here, consider the flash chamber contains, suppose, 100 kg of water. If suddenly 1 kg of water is removed by boiling, as pressure is reduced due to throttling of steam through steam nozzle, here the steam nozzle is there, approximately around about 2394 kilojoule of heat will be removed from the water, which is required for the evaporation of 1 kg of water. The fall in temperature of the remaining water will be 5.7 degrees Celsius, that is 2394 divided by 4.2 multiplied by 99, that is coming 5.7 degrees Celsius. So evaporating 1 kg of water, the remaining water will become another 5.7 degree cooler. By continuing this process, the remaining water can freeze. Water is the refrigerant used with the steam jet apparatus, and as water freezes at 0 degrees Celsius, we must either stop or devise a way to pump ice. As the consequence of this limitation, steam jet refrigeration is used almost exclusively for comfort cooling in air conditioning installation or in industrial processes where the lowest required temperatures for either cooling or dehydration will not fall below the freezing point of water. So that is the disadvantage of this system. So we need to use below freezing point of water. Next is vortex tube refrigeration. Vortex tube was invented by a French physicist named Georges Rank in 1931 when he was studying processes in a dust separated cyclone. The vortex tube, which is also known as Rank-Hilge vortex tube, which is a mechanical device that separates a compressed air into hot and cold stream. It has no moving parts. It is one of the non-conventional types of refrigeration system for the production of refrigeration. It consists of nozzle, a diaphragm, a valve, here the valve is, hot air side and cold air side. The nozzle is of converging or diverging type, or converging diverging type as per the design. And efficient nozzle is one which is designed to have higher velocity, greater mass flow and minimum inlet losses. The chamber is a portion of the nozzle and provides facility for the tangential entry of high velocity airstream into the hot side. Generally, the chambers are not of circular form, but the gradually converted spiral form. The hot side is cylindrical in cross section and is of different lengths as per design. A throttle valve obstructs the flow of air through the hot side, and also it controls the quantity of hot air passing through the vortex tube. The diaphragm is a cylindrical piece of small thickness and has a small hole of specific diameter at its center. The airstream traveling through the core of the hot side is emitted through the diaphragm hole. The cold side is cylindrical portion through which the cold air passes. So that is the vortex side, which is one of the method of refrigeration. Next is thermoelectric refrigeration, which is also one of the non-conventional refrigeration methods used for producing low temperature on the basis of reverse Seebeck effect. When the junctions of two dissimilar conductors are maintained at two different temperatures, T1 and T2, an electromotive force is generated, E, which is, or this phenomenon is called as a Seebeck effect. This principle is used in the thermocouples for measuring temperatures. When a battery is connected in between the junctions of two dissimilar conductors, which are initially maintained at the same temperature, and the current is made flow through the circuit, it is observed that the junction temperatures are different. So here T1 and T2 will be different. One junction becoming hot, T1 becoming hot, T2 becoming cold. This principle is reverse of the Seebeck effect and called Peltier effect. In this case of a refrigeration effect obtained at a cold junction, and heat is rejected to the surrounding at the hot junction. This principle is the basis for thermoelectric refrigeration systems. The position of cold and hot junctions can be reversed by reversing the direction of current through the conductor. These principles of Seebeck effect and Peltier effect are shown in figure. That is Seebeck effect and this is Peltier effect. The heat transfer rate at each junction is calculated by Q equal to phi I, where phi is nothing but Peltier coefficient in volts and I is current in amperes. Okay. So next is the magnetic refrigeration, which is a widely used refrigeration system, magnetic type. So magnetic refrigeration technique is used to attain extremely low temperature of the order of round about 1 Kelvin or below 1 Kelvin. This technique can also be used to produce cold in common refrigerators depending on the design of the system. Magnetic refrigeration was the first method developed for cooling below about 0.3 Kelvin. This cooling technology is based on magnetocaloric effect. Here a suitable material is subjected to a storage charging magnetic field. The decrease in the strength of an externally applied magnetic field allows the magnetic domains of a chosen material, that material is we are calling as magnetocaloric material, to become disoriented from the magnetic field by the agitating action of the thermal energy present in the material. If the material is isolated from the surrounding, that is no energy enters into the material during this time, the temperature of the material drops as the domains absorb thermal energy to perform their reorientation. The magnetocaloric effect is observed in the chemical element gadolinium and some of its alloys. The temperature of the gadolinium increases when subjected to a magnetic field, and its temperature decreases when the magnetic field leaves, which is shown in this figure. So this works the magnetic refrigeration. Okay, so these are the methods used to produce a refrigeration. Okay, so that's all about methods of refrigeration. We'll stop here. We'll continue with the same chapter in the next lecture. Thank you.